Love is kind and patient. Never jealous, boastful, proud, or rude. Love isn't selfish or quick-tempered. It doesn't keep a record of wrongs that others do. Love rejoices in the truth, but not in evil. Love is always supportive, loyal, hopeful, and trusting. Love never fails. Love. What is it? How can we describe this thing that consumes most of us in some way? Is it simply a chemical reaction that happens in our brain? Is it really something that we fall into? Is it really that controlling? I mean, don't we have a choice in the matter? And can we really love our spouses, our friends, our family, and fried cheese? Obviously, not all love is equal. And guys like C.S. Lewis, they tried to define different types of love. And he puts love into three categories: gift, need, and appreciative love. Gift love. What is that? Is it the desire to give presents to someone? No. Lewis takes it much farther than that and suggests that gift love is love that moves someone to plan and save for the future well-being of their family. Lewis suggests that gift love is divine love. Love that we only understand in part, but that Jesus knows in full through his relationship to the Father. For the Father gives all he is and has to the Son, and the Son gives himself back to the Father. Gift love is a selfless love, where one is willing to give their all to another. And then Lewis describes need love. And need love is the love of a child to their mother or father, the mother or father who provided protection and food. Need love is an affection for someone who supplies our needs. And then between gift love and need love, Lewis talks about appreciative love. Appreciative love is, well, it's best described by Lewis himself. He says, need love says to a woman, I cannot live without her. Gift love longs to give her happiness, comfort, protection, and if possible, wealth. But appreciative love gazes and holds its breath and is silent and rejoices that such a wonder should exist, even if it is not for him. But then Lewis also talked about the Greek definitions of love and placed those beside his own. The Greeks actually had four different words for love. The first is storge. Storge is familial affection and is both a gift love and a need love. But storge is not limited to family. It can also be for coworkers or roommates. In fact, you probably storge your BFF. And storge love is not chosen. It develops. It comes with biological relationships and grows with proximity. That's why one can feel storge for a cat or a dog. But then there's philia. This love is completely voluntary. It is chosen. It's a choice to friend someone. And it's not a need love. It's a selective love, a choice to give your time and energy to another. And then there's eros. Eros love is sexual love, erotic love. And let me be clear, eros is not sex. Eros is a complete and total commitment to another. Eros is a total gift love, but at the same time, it is totally wrapped up in the emotions of need and romance. Eros is one's desire for another, and that desire may lead to physical expressions. In fact, eros love is somewhat godlike. It's a love that requires total commitment to another, that is selfless and willing to sacrifice. But this is where the danger lies. The Bible tells us that God is love. And because of that, we can look at love, all the loves, and begin to make it little g gods. We begin to make all the loves little g gods. Love is so much a part of God that we often mistake things that are like love for that thing that we should revolve our lives around. Because these loves the ones that we've talked about, are so near to God, we are often tempted to worship them rather than worship that which is truly love, God Himself. But when we begin to worship any type of love, we actually destroy love and make an idol of it that is of like demon-like destruction in our lives. When we worship Eros love, we attempt to get it and take it at all costs. But the very act of doing that moves your actions from gift love to something that is self-centered and hurtful. In fact, all the loves that we've talked about today are corruptible by the human nature. The comfort that families sense because of storge can lead to insensitivity and rudeness, or its need to give can degenerate into a need to be needed, and jealousy. Psychologists call that codependency. And philia, well, it can lead to some amounts of pride and the attitudes that we see in cliques. We might even compromise ourselves in order to get with a certain crowd or to be considered someone else's BFF. Philia can turn into an obsession for friends on Facebook and Twitter. And philia can itself become, like all the other loves, a destructive idol in your life. And essentially, we all do a wonderful job of turning all these loves that are at their heart selfless into acts of selfishness and idolatry. But pure love is others-centered. It stretches outward and grows and grows and grows. And so there's this fourth love, a pure love. A love that can only come from God. A love that keeps all the other loves from being corrupted and turned into a sort of hatred. And so we must learn what this love is and infuse all the other loves with it in order to keep them alive. The Greek word for this love was agape. Agape love is totally unselfish love. This is the love that God has for the world. This is the love that God used to create the world that we know, everything that exists and more. This is the love that kept God from destroying a creation that continually rebels against Him. This is the love that causes God to desire personal intimacy with each of us. This is the love that causes God to build us up and desire the best for us and in us. This is the love that was at the heart of God's plan to save humanity from sin and death. This is the love that put Jesus on the cross as a substitute for us. And this is the love that raised Jesus from the dead so that we too may have eternal life in Christ if we make Him our Lord. Maria and I each have pretty strong personalities. Honestly, each of us is pretty stubborn. And while that combination can make for some pretty epic fights, neither of us likes being wrong, and both of us have no fear of debates. And I'm sure you can imagine that in our tiredness and grumpiness and stress, we can fight like the best of them. But you know when I first realized that I was gonna marry Maria? It was when we were fighting. I'm telling you the truth. I made the decision to marry Maria because of something I learned after one of our fights. When we were dating, I found that when we would argue or when we were annoyed with each other, I was still choosing to love her. I found that when she did something that really just angered me, I would still choose to go home and plan our next anniversary or go to the store and pick up flowers. Honestly, a marriage based on feelings alone, even good ones, won't last long. But thankfully, instead of basing love entirely on fleeting emotions, we both chose to love one another and chose to do so even when we felt the worst. And that put us in a selfless and sacrificial relationship. A relationship where we put each other first, even above our grumpy and stubborn attitudes. And as a side note, I probably angered her more than she angered me. But I'm confident she thought selflessly of me too during our fights. I mean, our relationship has been amazing, and most of the time it is very easy to love one another. But when we decided to love each other, even when our feelings made it hard to do so, we realized that God had put His love inside us for each other. I knew that I could die for Maria, I knew that I could die for her even when I was mad at her. I knew that I could love her with all the different kinds of love, including the highest form of love, which is agape love, sacrificial love. And I knew that it was that kind of love that was necessary for a marriage. I knew that without it, our relationship was doomed. And I knew that because I had been given by God the capability to think of Berea above everything else except God himself, that marrying her would be one of the best decisions I would ever make. In fact, we have this piece of furniture in our home. It was a piece of furniture that I had made. And this piece of furniture was also used in an elaborate proposal for her hand in marriage. What's funny is that I constructed that piece of furniture after having just fought with Berea. In fact, I can tell you that I was really mad at the time. I can't remember about what, but I know that I was pretty angry. But instead of focusing on my negative emotions, I decided to focus on doing something and planning something special for Maria. And I knew that because constructing that piece of furniture was something that actually calmed me down and got me thinking clearly, that choosing to love Maria, whether feeling happy or sad or angry or content or fearful or joyful for the rest of my life, was something I could do easily. You see, when I get to go get flowers for Maria after a fight, the purpose of doing that has nothing to do with Maria. I mean, I'm not trying to change her feelings. I'm not trying to change her at all. The flowers aren't supposed to be a peace offering that will make her happy with me again. No, the flowers are a way in which I can practice sacrificial love. The flowers are a choice to think of her above everything else. The flowers are God working in me to change my heart and make me selfless like Christ was selfless. Christ loves us. And though we dishonor him constantly with our disobedience and our destructive habits, Christ still chooses to love us and give us a gift much greater than flowers. Christ gave us his life. His justice should have destroyed us, but in his anger and in his desire to put his wrath upon us, he chose to give himself up for us instead and suffer the rejection of his Father and the brutal death of crucifixion so that we might have life. Christ decided to propose to his church when his people were being the most disrespectful and unloving to him. And so let us love one another. Let us love each other with the love that only comes from God himself, from love himself. Let us love each other with agape love, totally sacrificial and selfless love. Love is kind and patient, never jealous, boastful, proud, or rude. Love isn't selfish or quick-tempered. It doesn't keep a record of wrongs that others do. Love rejoices in the truth, but not in evil. Love is always supportive, loyal, hopeful, and trusting. Love never fails.